not going to happen or not a good idea or whatever. I think that, again, you know, I have this idea that there's some cultural universals. I think listening to people is somewhat of a cultural universal.
Mm-hmm.
And I think after a while, the answer may be that may be yes. In fact, even being more so,
mm-hmm.
oddly enough, then they might be able to, with maybe a person of their own race or their own gender, as odd as that may sound.
Mm-hmm.
And one reason is because sometimes I have to listen a little harder. I have to be a little more careful about that because I'm not getting it. But I'm trying.
That might be one of the things you might do differently.
They're putting more information out. It might be, but it's not very conscious if I'm doing it differently.
Right.
If I'm just trying to listen to them like I would listen to anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe they get more information that way.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't, they may feel that I'm at a disadvantage doing it.
Right. This is a little bit, something that Andy said brought this up. It's a little off the point. But I'm wondering what different people here feel about the idea of acknowledging up front that you're from a different culture. There's one woman that I work with, and from what she says, any time that she is with two people who are from a different culture, she will right away from the beginning acknowledge it, and I think ask, you know, if there's any discomfort at any time or whatever, you know. I mean, she puts it out there, for every, so it's not like this unspoken thing. And I don't know whether other people have done that or...
Well, what does she distinguish? I mean, I'm different.
Like
I'm
a different race
or
different ethnic group.
Okay. But not necessarily a lot of the other...
Not everything else,
okay.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, in her case, if it, let's say she's a white woman dealing with a black couple, she'll say, look, I'm not black. I'm different. I don't know exactly what else she does with other than to say, I think she just asked, are you comfortable with that? Are you comfortable being with me? Would you rather be with somebody else?
Okay.
Does that matter to you in this context? But I'm just wondering if other people have ever just sort of put that out on the table and what responses they've gotten to that. Has it made a difference one way or the other? Or?
Well, I actually thought about it, but real quickly, reaction I'm having to what you're saying is, you know, there's no judgment in this, but if we bring up that I'm a white male, that, and I know that, you know, I'm the only white male in the room here, and I hope that there's, you know, you're all aware of that, and are there any issues with it? I just made it an issue because why haven't I talked about my age?
That's right.
You know, that I'm a 60-year-old white male, or that I'm a, you know, that I'm a short person. Okay, so the moment that I mention that, it's almost like I make that issue. And then the other point I was going to make was that there's also, what you reminded me of, is that you have people from other cultures who have assimilated into our culture because of tremendous pressures to be like the dominant group. And if they're well along on that path, they're going to get a completely different set of behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And if you try to treat them as if they're from
the old country.
What you're going to get is somebody who will be reacting like a white person, and you know, becoming counterculture. So this is a really complicated thing. I think it's kind of careful what you put out there in terms of, you know, if you don't pull it all out there, I guess maybe don't put any of it out there.
Well, and also,
you know,
I think
about differences.
I think in a lot of ways we really look at race and gender as being two very obvious areas of cultural distinction, that when there are so many other patterns that may come out, you know, the person may be very different, look very different, but the real difference in communication or conflict style comes from their religion, something that we may never think to really even talk about. We, Michael and I, have worked on a case which is from a church from a different religion or a different denomination than I belong to. That was terribly difficult for me, and I would, after every meeting we had, I would tell Michael, I just don't understand it, and how do they say such things, and they're supposed to be loving, and they're supposed to be this and that, and it was sort of like, wait a second, this is not, you know, check that at the door, you know, and take them where they are, as you said, and that this is not about me, and in bringing in my value system to this group, but letting them deal with the conflict in the way that they do, based upon their culture.
Yeah, I had. Oh, I just have a couple comments. One, the first was a direct response to your question about if you have somebody in a mediation, a party, I think you gave the example of a workplace, or maybe it was sexual harassment or something. The problem that you would come, I think you would come across is that there's no way that you could have everybody be feel in a situation in which they're totally free to speak their mind, because you can't do that. Like, if they feel free to speak their mind because the mediator is just like them, well, who's to say that the person on the other side of the table is, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think that's really a difficult, something difficult to maneuver, and maybe the answer is somewhere in taking into account a lot of these differences that we've been talking about, while alongside that, thinking of presenting a model of communication for, you know, for more than one type of person. Yeah. The other thing is, I forgot. Oh, based on something you said, I can't remember if it comes back to me.
Now, would it surprise anyone if I were to tell you that when I am mediating with all black parties, it's a totally different kind of mediation?
No.
Tell us about
it. Well, I mean, it goes back to what you were saying, even about the, and I know that's a generalization, I can't say that for every case, but I would say that typically there's a different kind of communication style that's going on when we are all the same. And it's a lot more, this concept, I'm going back to Andy's comment of whether or not someone can feel free. I would say that if I've never seen the same kind of communication when there are different cultural groups represented than when, for me, when it's all African American, because then I see parties really feeling that they could speak their mind. Now, why that is...
And how does that affect outcomes? How does that affect what they get out of the process?
I think
not settlement or no settlement, but what they get out of the process.
I think what they get out of the process is just to have an opportunity to really just speak their mind in a way that they feel comfortable doing it, and just saying, look, you know, here, almost like the example you gave, here's the deal, you know, come on. You know, and just being very frank about what the situation is, and being able to communicate with one another and with me in a way that they are used to communicating, that they've grown up communicating, they've seen it in their families, and they've continued to. So, and many times they might even think that I'm going to kind of join in and sort of in this sort of camaraderie when really I'm trying very hard. That's another struggle, to kind of keep a certain amount of distance, to say we're still here for a reason and let's stay focused on the issues here. But a lot of times I just let it go, because it usually ends up working itself out more so than other kinds of cases. Okay. Here.
Two very short comments.
You were next, and then Brad.
Okay. The first one, kind of to amplify on what Jane was saying, slightly different twist. When you talk about the complainant, all right, whatever, that's the black woman, let's say, and I'm the old white guy, right? And what about the person on the other side of the table who may be different than that person? This might be, you know, a white person, might be somebody from a different place, different culture, and it kind of troubles me when we talk about this to always think about the initiator, if you will, and kind of walking on eggshells with that person and working with that person, when in point of fact, lots of times, not always, but lots of times, whoever's on the other side is, even if they're not racially different, they're culturally different, they're economically different, they're educationally different, and it troubles me.
And it goes back to that same question. Would that, well, do you see any constraints on that person? I mean, because they are different, constraints in their patterns of communication.
Yeah, I see constraints every time. People who are different, who are strangers, or who are in a setting that they're not necessarily comfortable with,
right,
come together. They're going to be a certain kind of way. They're going to be that way with, you're talking about, if you have all African Americans in a concert session or a
reconciliation session or mediation or whatever it is, they may want, those folks may want you to essentially be like them, talk like them, feel like them, because it's easier to get sucked in. When I have all Jewish customers, I get a whole different thing from them. They're each playing towards me, a little Yiddish, a little nod, a little talk about this and hey. You know, they want, you know. And maybe they feel more comfortable about it. I don't. I'm not saying that's going on with you.
Oh, yeah, I understand.
But that was my other comment.
Okay.
Brad?
Well, I'm interested in the Yiddish model mediation, but...
you don't want to know.
Julie, when you made the comment that it's a very different, I'm not sure what your exact words were, but a very different mediation when it's all African American and all Black mediating, would you say that you either, does the model of mediation change or your style or anything that as a general rule when you're in those situations that there's something you do differently that's outside just the rapport?
I can say that my style definitely changes. I'm trying to think of the process itself and whether or not that changes. I don't think so. I don't think it's much the process that is adapted, but more so the style. Meaning, just a lot more, I don't know, I guess there's a lot more conversation between us and not so much, okay, first statement, second. I think it's just a little looser, I guess is what I would say. That there's a comfort level that I don't have to spend the time, perhaps, developing the rapport because of that. And so some of the stuff that comes with your first hour of mediation when you're still gaining the trust and that sort of thing, I think there's an automatic trust just based upon a cultural connection.
So part of that might be us. You're able to be, you're more directive. I mean, so you don't have to maybe sooner or whatever that word means. But
yeah, I would say that that's probably something that one would find more directive and able to point to some of the things that I might see as being culturally related. As well, as you know, kind of talking in that sort of vein. Well, you know, we don't do that, you know, and kind of directing in that sort of way. I mean, I saw a look that was sort of like, you tell people, but I mean, that's an example. I mean, I can't think of, but I'm trying to convey that it's sort of a...
You know what I mean? Look at my face. That's what I was thinking, that you could be more directed that way and actually say stuff as opposed, which isn't necessarily what we would normally teach.
Right.
And I thought you would.
Not at CCR. Like this never happens when I'm mediating with CCR. Right. Okay. Here, and then we'll go around.
Well, I had a question kind of related to that and also related to, I remembered my question or my comment from earlier, and that's that there are a lot of cultural differences that have very little to do with race or age, but have to do with, you know, I don't know, as simple as, oh, if you're from New York, you know, you're aggressive versus assertive, you know, or if you're an artist, the way you communicate is flaky and you're not logical, and there are all these things that there's no way that you can identify. So I get a little nervous, I guess. I like the idea of a mediation in which, not that you're not acknowledging differences, because being aware of your biases and being aware of, you know, potential, you know, all the possibilities of behaviors that might come out, that's okay, that's fine.
Right.
I get a little nervous about, you know, trying to stereotype or assign a certain way of communication or whatever to certain either age groups or ethnicities or sex or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the idea that you go in assuming everybody is different and has to start from ground zero. Because if you have, I mean, yes, maybe it's true that, I mean, if I'm with a bunch of people like me, whatever that is, I don't really have anything like that, where if I were to enter into a mediation and they're all like Janie Bozak, I'm like, okay, I'm home. And, you know, I don't know what that would look like for me personally. But
But I don't know. I guess I think that, you know, even though, and if there were a situation like that, it would be, some things would be easier. For me, I don't know if that's an ideal to go for.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's just a, kind of maybe throwing that out as a comment.
Right. And one of the things that you said is that in terms of trying to find out how you might adjust or evaluate how a different culture, the key here is that we have biases, and when you go into a mediation session, to make a judgment about how someone is communicating or how they are handling the conflict because of our own cultural experience means that we may just be wrong, that this person who is not looking at the other person in the eye isn't trying to avoid the conflict like we might think, because that's our experience, that when you don't look at the person in the eye, that's what that means. Just stopping to think for a minute, maybe there's something else behind it. Maybe this is a cultural issue. Maybe I should ask about it. Maybe during caucus I should say, you know, I see that it's hard for you to look at the other person in the eye. Why is that, as we said, asking directly? And the person might say, because in my culture, we don't do that. So it's just being aware enough. And I certainly wasn't trying to make it seem that that's the ideal, although I can't say it's helpful in those situations when there is that sort of looser feel that it can be helpful in a process. And but I don't think that that's something that we all should say, okay, well then let's all try to find people that are just like us culturally and just mediate those cases so we can skip the developing the rapport stage. You know?
Because I think in some ways, if you I was thinking what you said, Jane, to me it would almost be boring. Yeah. I mean, if I there were two people like me.
Right.
I mean, in some ways it keeps me, I think it's, but I mean, if I go in and it's cultures that I don't know or don't understand, in some ways, that's helpful too. I mean, that I have that interest, and in some ways, especially if they're of the same culture, that I'm thinking sometimes of foreign cultures, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Then, in some ways, they it almost unites them to sort of explain or to talk more about what it is they need to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
In some ways,
mm-hmm.
And plus my being sort of interested in that.
Mm-hmm.
I think. More focused.
Right. Makes it interesting.
Right.
Andy and Michael.
I was just thinking a couple things. One is that when we talk about how we mediate all black folks and stuff, it's a totally different experience. I can understand that. Like, all I have to do is think about having brunch with a bunch of queens, and I don't understand what it's like to have everybody in the room be the same as you and this sort of rock and roll. But where I get confused about this is what exactly think about cultural differences in mediation. What's the sort of goal, if you will, of that awareness? Because on the one hand, I think, okay, so I've got a bunch of white people. Well, they're not all the same either. And as you raise the issue, even within the same culture, there's a whole lot of different stuff that can go on.
Right.
I mean, it's not part of my cultural experience that you don't look away from people or that you refuse to make eye contact. But have I ever seen plenty of people in mediation who, I think probably just don't like looking other people in the eye.
Yeah.
It's nothing behind it, but it's just there. So do you deal with cultural differences, or should you deal with cross-cultural differences somehow differently, or should you think of them differently, approach them differently, than you would with all these kinds of differences that are present in your own culture? Is there a reason to do that? And then the second thing is, if since there's no such thing, as far as I can tell, as leveling the playing field, finding this place where we're all on the same ground and we're all connected in the same way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for example, we're talking about speaking freely or speaking your mind freely. Is that a cultural assumption? Or is that cultural, the idea that we all need to speak freely? I don't know. Maybe it is.
And see, and I was thinking when you said that, which is why I responded that way, was that how few opportunities there are to speak freely. And that's my, well, okay, you obviously have a, I know I said I'd come right to you, Michael, but there's urgency here.
No, I'm this amen in the corner. Mm-hmm. But she mentioned that the joy of having the differences, but as an African-American female, the joy of having the opportunity to be in a situation to be all relaxed. And my other point is, I'm surprised no one mentioned it, but it's probably common amongst us, that if you go home or your husband or whatever, and the guys are there, don't they talk a little different when they know you're not in the house? And we as women say things differently when we know that there's no men around. So I guess that goes back to saying if the culture is the same, you kind of relax and say some things that you wouldn't normally say if the setting was different.
And I think, Andy, as you were saying, I think the key is to not just, part of the nature of being a mediator really is, and I know we say that we don't have all the answers, and we say that, but really part of the nature of being a mediator is that we have the right way to communicate and the right way to resolve conflict. I mean, that's really part, in a lot of ways, in a lot of ways, that's part of our training, that we have this process that works to resolve conflict and to talk to one another. And we can help facilitate that process. That's our role. And so the goal is, you know, is to really just keep that in mind, that there are other ways. They still, I know, it's radical. And it all may fit under the model. I mean, it all fits under this model of mediation, and it fits under this facilitated communication and constructive conflict resolution, but there are some ways, some twists and turns that it may take based upon these differences. And just to recognize that it's not just, here's the model and it really works every time because people are different. And from what we've seen that in our mediations. Michael.
Well, I was going to just tell us the story. You have to take it as is. I have no idea what it means, but it seems like it's relevant.
Okay. We'll decide.
Yeah. And both training stories. One is that sometimes when we're doing the training and I'm playing a party, and the person that we're training is really a very good mediator, and somebody sitting across the table may be culturally different than I am, or apparently so, but I really don't know what happened in mediation by the time it's over. I mean, if somebody's not very good that I'm training, I know everything that happened. But if they're really good, I haven't a clue how I got from the position I was in to where we got, because the mediator was so good at it. It's like a guiding hand that I don't even realize what's going on. I couldn't tell you how I got what we got. And so I don't know, I mean, looking at it that way, I guess I'm sort of, you know, moving over to Andy's side a little bit. Looking at it that way, I'm not sure that it would matter very much, you know, as Steve said, in terms of the outcome. Mm-hmm. It may matter in exactly how we got there. Maybe if you follow the lines, they would look somewhat different.
Right.
Or there's a certain comfort level that would be different, or the language would be different. I don't think it's right. I'm just saying I do have, you know, I remember three or four times when I noticed that. And the other thing, which I'm not even sure if it's applicable, but somehow or other I think it applies, and that is that once we were doing a training, I remember it was a Kent Law student, and she was having an awful time getting someone to pay attention to her. So she was the mediator, and the party just wasn't cooperating with her at all. And I don't know why, but I said, have you ever done martial arts? She said, yes. I said, try sending key. And she did, and she got the cooperation, which means it's a whole different level of communication, entirely different. There's nothing that's on the board here at all that can be, I mean, if there's any accuracy to it.
What I wonder is if you were talking about how you're feeling as a mediator, and then there's the issue of how the parties are feeling about it, and then the outcome. Mm-hmm. So, and how important is it for the mediator to be really comfortable during the session or not?
Like the session that you're talking about, where it was black party, two black parties, mm-hmm. and you were the mediator. No. You may have felt very different sitting in the mediator's chair than I might have felt sitting in the mediator's chair. I don't know how different they would have felt talking to one another with me sitting in the mediator's chair than they did with you sitting there. So certainly they might have communicated with me at a different level, and I might have asked different types of questions or something, but I don't know how much it would affect. I mean, we're there for them. They're not there for us. We're there for them. And if they're talking to each other, however they want to do it, that's what is supposed to be happening.
Right. But the other thing that could come up is our earlier discussion regarding even seeing the mediator as an authority figure, and how, and someone outside of the community, and maybe since we don't like to bring issues outside of the community, it could be a hindrance. It may not. I'm in total agreement with Michael's last comment and with Andy saying that what we can do is try to create the best environment possible, regardless of the differences, for people to communicate with one another. I mean, that's what we do. And it may take longer, it may be a different route, but I'm confident that you could get to that same place, you know, just as easily as, or maybe not just as easily, but you can get to that same place as anyone else could who's from the same cultural background. But just recognizing that there may be some different roads you have to take because of that, keeping those differences in mind.
Actually, I'd like to change my mind.
Uh-oh.
Which is because when I think of people walking out of mediations I've done, mm-hmm. I can only think of two of them. Both people were African American, mm-hmm. and it happened early on in mediation.
Mm-hmm. Or walking out.
Oh, walked out of the session.
And so it may be that if we have time, maybe these cross-cultural differences won't matter as often if you do everything right and you're sensitive. Maybe, I don't know. But it also may be that sometimes there's not time to get it right. And so therefore, the race or the sex or whatever of the person doing mediation might be important. Mm-hmm.
Right. Hence, sometimes seeing the co-mediations to say right off the bat, let's try to kind of address that.
Yeah,
one more comment.
To me, it seems, perhaps it comes, you know, I'm sitting here thinking, mm-hmm. okay, here I am, I'm a white woman, from a particular place, a particular religion, what's my responsibility? For the parties, I come to CCR, I don't think I've had a Caucasian party. Mm-hmm. But then I say, well, you know, if what we're doing in mediation is empowering the parties, mm-hmm. maybe this is some power we have to give to the parties up front. Mm-hmm. And if their preference is that, they have as a mediator a particular flavor of person, then I say it's voluntary, that's their right. If that's available, you know, fine. If it's not available, they'll need to, you know, kind of reality test on that. But that's their right. But it's not kind of me that makes that decision for them. I mean, I think that's a decision they're going to have to make for themselves. The same way, you talk about, you know, lists of mediators and you strike this and strike that and the more kind of commercial thing. Yeah, I think perhaps it can be the same thing, that this is for the parties to say.
Right. I don't know. I sat here the whole time, and I think about where I'm from and my community, and for every single thing, I have a quick response in my head that if I were a party and didn't know anything about mediation, how I would respond. And it's hard. I don't know what to say. I don't know why I felt this way and why I kept thinking all these thoughts in my head every time somebody mentioned something, but I can imagine if it's inside of me, that it's definitely inside of a lot of other people. Mm-hmm. And there is no answer to it. I don't know.
Right.
I don't know. I can just only tell you how I feel and how I felt just sitting here this whole session. Mm-hmm. I felt like...
One example?
It's like I can hit every single thing.